Hi everyone, if you or someone you know is using cocaine in the long term, then this is for you. So we're going to talk about cognitive decline associated with long-term cocaine use. So this is not acute brain injury. This is long-term cognitive decline because of cocaine use. And we're going to talk about the neuroanatomy, mechanisms, and functional deficits. So long-term cocaine use leads to significant cognitive impairments due to its damaging effect on various brain regions. And these impairments arise from dopaminergic dysfunction, glutaminergic dysregulation, neurotoxicity, and structural brain changes. So we will explore the specific cognitive deficits, the underlying neurobiological mechanisms, and how these changes impact on everyday functioning. So what are the major long-term cognitive deficits in chronic cocaine users? And I'm not talking a one-off, I'm talking about long-term, daily, weekly, chronic cocaine users. So research suggests that long-term cocaine users experience deficits in multiple cognitive domains, including attention, concentration, impaired executive functioning, and executive functioning is problem solving, sequencing, arranging, planning, memory impairments, impaired cognitive flexibility, so being agile, being able to adapt, behavioral rigidity, again, unable to adapt to social cues, and emotional dysregulation and cognitive affect deficits. Now, emotional dysregulation is a risk factor for relapse. If you're in recovery and you're feeling emotionally dysregulated, that is going to make you go back to tried and tested means of alleviating your emotional dysregulation, your emotional pain. That, in turn, is going to risk your relapse. So let's look in a bit more detail into impaired executive functioning in chronic cocaine users. So we've got poor impulse control and risky taking behavior. This is all about impulsivity. So users struggle to inhibit impulsive actions, making them more likely to engage in risky behaviors. For instance, unprotected sex, financial irresponsibility, criminal activities. And this is due to activation, or rather a failure of activation, a reduced activation of the PFC, the prefrontal cortex, which normally suppresses impulsive urges. So that's impulsivity. And then we've got deficient problem-solving and decision-making issues. So chronic cocaine users perform poorly on tasks requiring flexible thinking and strategic planning, e.g. the Wisconsin card sorting test. This impairment is linked to orbitofrontal cortical dysfunction, which disrupts the ability to learn from past mistakes and to adjust behavior accordingly. So you cannot learn from experience, you cannot problem solve. So now we've got impulsivity and poor problem-solving ability. And then we've got cognitive control and working memory deficits. So the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, the DLPFC, that region of the brain supports working memory, which is essential for maintaining and manipulating information. So being able to hold multiple facts or figures in your head at one time. Cocaine reduces dorsolateral prefrontal cortical activation, leading to difficulty in concentrating, multitasking, and difficulty in recalling information in real time. It gets worse. Then we have deficits in attention and concentration, and we have memory impairments. So looking at attention and concentration. So chronic cocaine use damages dopaminergic and noradrenergic systems, both of which are critical for sustained attention and vigilance. And remember, a lot of people with substance use disorders think that they've got attention deficit hyperkinetic disorder, ADHD. This is why it's really important to separate out substance use as a diagnosis of causing attention deficit from ADHD causing attention deficit. Now, I'm not saying that you cannot have both, but what I am saying is that if you are suffering from a substance use disorder, it's very difficult to make the diagnosis of attention deficit hyperkinetic disorder without a proper longitudinal assessment, including a history of difficulties in childhood. And that's because they both present with poor attention in a cross-sectional analysis. So let's look exactly at what kind of attentional deficits we're talking about. So we've got a reduced attention span. Cocaine users struggle with sustained focus on complex tasks. Again, very similar to ADHD. There's increased distractibility. Again, very much like ADHD. And this is due to dopamine depletion. And is it any wonder that in ADHD, we use dopaminergic drugs? Users of cocaine, chronic users of cocaine, find it harder to filter out irrelevant stimuli, making it more difficult to focus, especially in noisy environments. Then we've got slower cognitive processing. So cocaine reduces neural efficiency, making it harder to process information quickly and accurately. So attention deficit can be due to chronic cocaine use. Then we move to memory impairments. So cocaine causes hippocampal damage. Hippocampus is where we begin to start to handle memory. So the hippocampus is kind of the random access memory of our brain. And from that random access memory, overnight during sleep, we then transfer salient information into our cortical networks, into our hard drives. So you cannot get to the hard drive without going through the random access memory, which is the hippocampus. And cocaine damages the hippocampus, therefore you find it difficult to actually encode into the long-term memory really salient information. So you then end up having deficits in short-term memory, deficits in verbal learning, and deficits in recallability. And as specific types of memory impairment, we've got episodic memory. This is a memory for personal life events. So users have difficulty remembering recent experiences and events. And again, this is specifically due to hippocampal atrophy and a disrupted glutamate signaling. So then we have deficits in working memory. So this is the memory that you need to use to actually keep in the front of your mind a list of figures of facts. So for instance, if you're making an order, if you're working as a waiter, and you're making a food order, the working memory is the memory that you use to actually encompass that information that you need to write down on a piece of paper to then go into the kitchen. Cocaine users struggle with holding and manipulating information, e.g. remembering a phone number while dialing, or taking a food order. And this correlates with decreased activity in the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And then we've got reduced verbal memory and learning. So chronic cocaine users struggle to retain and recall new words, new concepts, and in particular, accept new instructions. And this is linked to damage in the left temporal lobe and hippocampus. So we have an ever-increasing range of impairments. And then we move to cognitive flexibility and emotional regulation. So chronic cocaine users have impaired cognitive flexibility and behavioral rigidity. Cocaine use impairs the ability to adapt to new information and to adjust behavior. So this can manifest as perseverative errors. So basically repetitive mistakes, making the same mistake again and again and again. Users continue using ineffective strategies instead of adjusting to new rules. And this is due to dysfunction of the orbital frontal cortex. And this OFC is critical for behavioral adaptation. And then we have reduced creativity and problem solving. So cocaine disrupts frontal lobe function, making it difficult to generate new ideas or to think in the abstract. And this impairs work performance and everyday decision making. Then we move to emotional dysregulation and cognitive affective deficits. So cocaine use causes abnormal interactions between the prefrontal cortex, the amygdala, which is the center for rage, and the limbic system. And this leads to heightened emotional reactivity. Forgive my language here, but it really, the amygdala is where we have the fuck it switch. And if you've got an overreactive amygdala, you will experience an increased irritability, aggression, mood swings, and you will then be prone to relapse. And this is all due to amygdala hyperreactivity, where you react or you overreact to minor stressors. And so there's a balance between overreactive amygdala and underactive prefrontal cortex. Then we have difficulty interpreting social cues. So users, chronic users, struggle to recognize emotions in others or facial expressions in others or body language in others, leading to difficulties in overall communication and strained relationships. Again, this is particularly a function of the orbit of frontal cortex, which we know affects emotional regulation. So again, difficulty in communicating with people leads to strained relationships, leads to social isolation, which again is a risk factor for relapse. And then poor stress tolerance. And again, we've already talked about the fuck it switch. Cocaine increases cortisol, which is a stress hormone, increases cortisol levels, making users highly sensitive to stress. And this again contributes to relapse risk because, as we know, stress triggers cravings, triggers relapse. Now let's look at the neurobiological mechanisms of cognitive decline. The cognitive impairments in chronic cocaine users are due to neurochemical disruptions, structural damage, and functional connectivity changes. And so we'll look at these in detail now. So first of all, we've got dysregulation of neurotransmitters. We've got dopaminergic and glutaminergic dysregulation. If we're looking at dopaminergic dysregulation, we have reduced dopamine receptor density. In particular, the D2 receptor is downregulated. So long-term cocaine use depletes dopamine receptors in the nucleus accumbens and prefrontal cortex, and this leads to anhedonia, poor motivation, and impaired decision-making. And we've got weakened dopaminergic connectivity. So cocaine disrupts dopamine signaling between the prefrontal cortex and the limbic system, and also, for that matter, also the amygdala. And this impairs cognitive control, increasing impulsivity, cravings, and also emotional dysregulation. If we look at the glutamate system, so cocaine causes excessive glutamate release, leading to excitotoxicity, so neuronal damage due to overstimulation. And over time, glutamate signaling in the prefrontal cortex becomes impaired, resulting in cognitive deficits, so resulting in cognitive inflexibility, which is the inability to switch between tasks, deficits in working memory, and reduced neuroplasticity, making learning more difficult. So you've got long-term cognitive and emotional disruption due to dysregulation of the dopamine system and the glutamate system. Then we've got structural brain damage and oxidative stress. So neuroimaging studies show that long-term cocaine users have got significant structural abnormalities. They've got gray matter abnormalities and white matter abnormalities. So let's look at the gray matter. We've got prefrontal cortex shrinkage, and that correlates with poor impulse control and decision-making deficits. We've already mentioned the hippocampal atrophy leading to memory impairment. And we've got reduction in the mass of the orbit of frontal cortex, resulting in compulsive drug-seeking behavior. And then we've got white matter abnormalities, and it's the white matter in the brain that connects different parts of the brain. So cocaine disrupts myelin integrity, and myelin is the kind of the insulation around nerves that makes nerves go white. And without myelin, you have nerve damage, and therefore a disruption of myelin integrity causes a slowing of the neural networks, a slowing of neural communication. And this leads to reduced cognitive processing speed and reaction times. So that's structural brain damage. And then we move to oxidative stress and neuroinflammation. So cocaine increases free radical production, leading to oxidative damage. And chronic cocaine use triggers neuroinflammation, further damaging the dopaminergic and glutaminergic pathways. What are the real-world implications of cocaine-induced cognitive decline? So long-term users of cocaine, they've got this brain dysfunction, and how does it really affect them? Well, occupational impairment. So you're just not as good as you think you are in your jobs because you cannot concentrate, you cannot make decisions, and ultimately it's very difficult to perform at a high level and to maintain employment. You've also got increased absenteeism, you've got poor work performance, and you run the risk of being sacked. as a result of which you have financial and legal consequences. Again, not only have you lost your job, but you've also got impulsivity and risk-taking behavior, and that increases the likelihood of making poor financial decisions, and it also increases the likelihood of doing something silly and getting arrested for it. So you've got these legal issues due to reckless behavior. And then, of course, that leads to emotional difficulties. So you've got emotional dysregulation leading to conflict and social isolation, loss of relationships, which is a key diagnostic criterion for substance use disorder. You've got the reduced ability to empathize and to communicate effectively because you cannot follow cues. So chronic cocaine use causes cognitive decline, which affects you occupationally, affects you legally, financially, and also affects your relationships. The answer to the question, can the brain recover, is complicated, but yes, the brain can recover. So firstly, we need to understand that the brain is able to undergo a process of neuroplasticity, and neuroplasticity is change in the way that the neurons connect and function. So some functions, some cognitive functions can recover with prolonged abstinence. And this is why we advocate for abstinence. This is why I advocate for abstinence when I'm talking to people who do use cocaine. We need to think about cognitive rehabilitation programs, lifestyle intervention measures such as exercise and dopamine modulating treatments. These can all enhance recovery. What we see is that after 1 year of sobriety, attention and working memory get back to normal. Within 12 to 18 months, we get dopamine receptor density approaching normal, but then even beyond 18 months, up to 24 months, you can still have persistent impairments, especially if you've got severe prefrontal cortical damage. That may be irreversible, leading to persistent executive function impairments. So the short answer is yes, the brain can recover. The nuanced answer is it does take a while. You've got to pay particular attention to abstinence and lifestyle interventions. And you have to be aware that there may not be a complete 100% recovery of your executive function. To conclude, in chronic cocaine users, multiple cognitive domains are affected. So there is potentially a severe decline in executive function, memory, attention, and emotional regulation. This is driven by dysfunction in neurotransmitter systems, in particular dopamine and glutamate. It's also driven by oxidative stress and structural brain damage. There is the potential for recovery, especially after significant periods of abstinence and adherence to lifestyle intervention programs. But long-lasting damage can still persist, especially in severe chronic use of cocaine. Long-term use leaves lasting impairments that can affect daily life, relationships, and occupational functioning. So if you or someone you know is affected by chronic cocaine use, it is absolutely vital for you to seek professional help. That's all for today, folks. My name's Dr. Ferghal Armstrong, and this has been Cracking Addiction.